All right, good evening. Happy Wednesday. God bless each and every one of you. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the virtual house of God. Amen. Greetings to each of you on this wonderful night. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. Tonight, we honor God for this amazing privilege to come together as a church family. Amen. To study the word of God. And I am privileged and honored to be able to share with you all what God has to say to us on this evening. Amen. I pray and hope that you all have had a great day. I pray and hope that the grace of God has been gripping you and that the love of God has been holding you all the day long. Yeah. That's my prayer. And so I'm excited and I'm grateful to be able to share the word of God on this evening. All right, y'all, we're going to begin with a word of prayer, of course, but we want to invite God into our time, of course, and we just thank God for all that he's doing. And so without any further ado, let us go ahead and get into this word. But first, we're going to pray. So let's do that. Amen. Let's, if you can, bow your heads and close your eyes with me as we talk to God and ask him to bless our moments together. Okay. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you. We bless you. We honor you. And it is a joy to be in your presence right now. God, in your presence is the fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And we, your people tonight, want to say thank you firstly and foremost for blessing us, God, to be here together. Thank you for the St. John Missionary Baptist Church. Thank you for this midweek Bible study worship experience. Thank you for your grace, God. Thank you for your love, Lord. Thank you for calling us out of the darkness and inserting us into your marvelous light. Thank you for allowing us this blessed opportunity to be a part of the ministry and the word of God that's about to go forth on this evening. I pray as always, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. Oh, Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. And we thank you so very much. I pray a choice blessing over each person that's listening to me and looking at me on this virtual Facebook live feed tonight, God. I pray that you would just shower down blessings over every person that. Okay. All right. We still there? Okay. I got a little pop-up message. It kind of threw me off. I hope you guys are good. Okay. I'm still here. Looks like you guys, a few of us are still here. All right. Amen. We're back here. And so God bless you all. The video was interrupted. It was interrupted, but that's okay. We're going to continue to go with God on tonight. All right. We're going with God and we trust him and we love him and we thank him. All right. Well, good evening again. If you just came on, I just wanted to share a quick word of greetings to each of you. And God bless you. And God is just good no matter what we experience and go through. We serve an all-sufficient God. We serve a God that cannot fail us, a God that has never lost a battle. Amen. He is undefeated. Yes. And because God is the greatest power, we shall never be defeated. I'm motivated tonight. I got on my school shirt. It says, live your calling. Amen. SWBTS.edu, Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. I start class tomorrow. And so we thank God. I'm ready though, y'all. I've been reading up and preparing and I've already submitted my questions for the class discussion tomorrow. And so I'm excited about this fall semester. I'm just getting closer and closer to the finish line. And God is faithful. So we thank him. We will make it. We will make it by the grace of the Lord. And I thank you all for all of your great prayers and your encouragement. Amen. I want to just go ahead and put a plug in right now. If you guys think about me tomorrow around 10 a.m., I'll be in class. Just whisper a word of prayer for Pastor Trey Thomas. Thank you so much in advance. We're going to be all right. I was listening to that song by Ty Tribbett earlier today. We're going to be all right. That's not perfect grammar, but it's good grace. Amen. To know that in the midst of everything, we as God's people are going to be all right. We can weather any storm that comes our way, because if God be for us, who can be against us? Yeah, we are more than conquerors. Yes, Lord. We thank God for his strength on display in our lives. All right, y'all, we're going to go ahead and get into the word. And I'm just excited to be able to share this word with you all. So we're studying the book of Ephesians, and we're just walking through this amazing book. I've shared with you all in the previous two settings that the book of Ephesians is one of the prison epistles written by the Apostle Paul. Okay, it's one of four letters written while Paul was under house arrest. Okay, so he's locked up, but the word of God is not locked up. And the power of God in his life, moving and working in his life, is not in chains. Amen. So he's able to pen this letter written to the church at Ephesus, the church at Ephesus written to the church called Ephesians, the Ephesians, the church at Ephesus. And so he writes this letter that consists of six chapters, and it's broken up 3-3. The first half is the content, and the second half deals with conduct. And we've talked about all of that in the introduction a couple of weeks ago. All right. Well, we're in chapter 2 tonight. We've already covered every verse in chapter 1, which consisted of 23 verses. We've walked through each of those verses. Tonight, I want to call your prayerful attention to Ephesians chapter 2. And we'll begin at verse 1, and we'll work our way down to verse number 10. We'll cover all 10 verses tonight in our time together. Okay, so I want to go ahead and just read the text, and we're going to just go ahead and allow the Holy Spirit to be our teacher tonight. I'm just the vehicle. I'm just the vessel, but God has put a treasure in this earthen vessel. Amen. Hallelujah. So this is what the word of the Lord says from the New King James Version, the Ephesians chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, please feel free to read along with me because I want you to see this also. Okay, the text says this. And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Verse 3, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. Verse number 4 is the shift, y'all. And the reason why I know it's a shift is because the first word in the verse is but. I share all the time that God always gives us a big but. And hallelujah for that. And so the but gives us the transition. Verses 1 through 3 gives us one thought. And as we work through this, we'll see the second thought in verses 4 through 7. And then we'll conclude with a third thought in verses 8, 9, and 10. Three teaching principles that I want to drop on you in your hearing tonight. And so we'll pick up at the transitional verse, which is verse 4. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Glory to God. And now we have the final leg of what we're going to deal with, verses 8, 9, and 10. Listen to this. This is so powerful. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Verse 9, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Verse 10 concludes, and it says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Praise God for his word on tonight. Brothers and sisters, I want to take a moment to teach and share a lesson simply entitled God's Amazing Grace. God's Amazing Grace. This is what we see on display tonight in our text, verses 1 through 10, Ephesians chapter 2. Really, the context shows us that the theme of these 10 verses hone in on the idea of God's amazing grace. That's what I want to share with you tonight. I want to give you this introduction that simply says, when a person truly understands that oxygen is a gift, they will not smoke. If a person comprehends that good health is a gift, they're not going to abuse drugs. When a Christian, listen to this, when a Christian understands that grace is a gift of God, they will make the choice to say no to wrong and yes to right. If a Christian loses sight of grace, then they become irresponsible with the life given to them by God. Oh, glory right now, tonight. We're talking about God's amazing grace. And I think it's so important that we embrace the grace of God, that you know that grace is God's righteousness at Christ's expense. I use that all the time as an acronym, as an acrostic, to help us to understand and appreciate that God's grace is God's righteousness at Christ's expense. In other words, it took Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, to die on the cross of Calvary over 2,000 years ago for the salvation of our lost souls. And because of his vicarious death, we now can experience eternal life through his grace given to us by our faith appropriated in him. So it's according to our faith, but it's by his grace. And we're going to see that later in this text. But I'm just trying to give us a platform to lift off on, to really understand the whole matter and significance of what grace really is all about. God's grace is truly amazing. It's not just a cliche. It's not just a song that we sing. It is a reality that God's grace is amazing. Glory to God tonight. And so as we just go ahead and delve into our text, again, verses 1-3, I want to read this to you. And I want you to really see that the grace of God shows us these three levels. And I want to just go ahead and get right to it. He shows us who we used to be prior to our salvation experience. Listen to this. He says, and you he made alive. Now, if he had to make us alive, that signifies clearly that we were dead, were past tense. And so I need you to notice the past tense terminology that you can clearly see in verses 1, 2, and 3. Listen to it again. And you he made alive who were, past tense, dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, ED, past tense, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. I need to put a pin right there and tell you that Paul is addressing spiritual warfare right here in Ephesians chapter 2 at verse number 3. He addresses the fact, as a matter of fact, that's verse number 2. At verse number 2, Ephesians 2:2, Paul addresses this matter of spiritual warfare because our waging of warfare, brothers and sisters, is not against flesh and blood. It's not against you. It's not against me. It's not against one another. It's against principalities, according to Ephesians chapter 6. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, spiritual wickedness in high places. It's a spiritual warfare. And the way that we wage war is not in a physical sense, but in a spiritual sense. We wage war through prayer and praise. We get the devil running by praising the name Jesus and praying in the name of Jesus. And as we appropriate the name of Jesus over our lives and speak victory and speak faith over fear and speak success over failure, God moves on our behalf. And so we bless God tonight for the reality that although the enemy does have power, he doesn't have all power. He is not omnipotent. Only our God is all powerful. Only our God is omniscient, meaning he knows everything. And only our God is omnipresent, meaning he's everywhere at the same time. The devil does have some power, but really and truly, the devil is only powerful when we allow him to activate the power by giving in to the vices and temptations and the allurings of what he tries to do to pull us away from the grace of God. But as long as we stay in the grip of God's grace, we shall never be defeated. Glory right now. Verse number three. Well, let me just read verse number two one more time because I need you to see all of this. In which you once walked, past tense ED, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Verse three, among whom also we all once conducted, ED, past tense, ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. Okay? And so firstly, brothers and sisters, the first thing that I want to drop on you concerning God's amazing grace as it relates to this text is verses 1 through 3 shows us who we were, and it gives us a glimpse of the pre-Christ position. Amen. Verses 1 through 3 in this text shows us tonight our pre-Christ position. That prior to Christ Jesus, we were dead. Prior to Christ's position in our lives, we did walk according to the trespasses and sins. We did walk according to the course of this world. The devil was our master. The devil was he was pulling the strings of our heart. But now, since we've fallen in love with Jesus, and now since we've walked in the newness of life, now that we've acquired salvation through faith, by grace, now that we are in the grip of God's grace, we are now saved. But this firstly shows us, verses 1, 2, and 3, shows us the pre-Christ position. It's a pre-conversion place, y'all. It shows us what we used to be like prior to our new birth in Jesus Christ. And oh, what a shame it was how we used to live. But isn't it a joy to know that that's our past and it is not our present? It is not our right now, which gives us hope to know that our tomorrow is even brighter as we walk in the grace of God in our right now. And as we walk in the grace of God in our present, that assures us that God is going to bless us in our not yet distant future. So we bless God even for the pre-Christ position, because the pre-Christ condition, according to position, that is, according to the grace of God, says that God is faithful. And it reveals his faithfulness in that God could have cut us off when we were in our sins, when we were walking according to the patterns of this world, according to the courses of this world. But God didn't see fit to leave us in that place of sin. He redeemed us. He purchased us and he snatched us out of the peril. In other words, it gives us really a picture of a burning house and how we used to live in that burning house. We didn't know that our house was on fire, but it was. But God, his son, Jesus, that is, went into the burning house and snatched us out and saved us. And now we are forever forgiven and are a part of the household of faith. And we bless God for the pre-Christ position. But not only do we see that, I want to show you the shift. Somebody say shift, or type in shift in the comment section, even right now. The shift happens at verse number 4, because we see that term, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love. That's just beautiful terminology. I love what Paul writes right there. He says God is rich in mercy. Mercy gives us the understanding of God withholding back due punishment. Mercy says that we deserve the death penalty, but God was merciful. We deserve to go to jail, but God was merciful. We deserve to be cut off a long time ago, but God was merciful. God is rich in mercy, and he has a great love for us, with which he loved us even when we were dead in trespasses. Here's what he did. He made us alive. And the term that I really want you to gravitate toward right now is the term together, y'all. Somebody type that in the comment section. You ought to type that right now and say together. Type together, because it's three different times mentioned. He made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, verse 6, and raised us up together. and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. I need you to see, secondly, brothers and sisters, that not only do we see the pre-Christ position in verses 1-3, but secondly, we see the powerful connection of partnership. The powerful connection of partnership in verses 4-7. And the reason why I say it's a powerful connection, because of the term together. Amen. There's strength together. We're better together. We're stronger together. As a church family, God can bless us more together. As husband and wives together working, you can be better off, and you can function as a family together, walking in harmony together. Our children are better together because we are one together. And God wants us to operate as a family of faith. And as we operate together, God blesses us that way, because it's a powerful connection, a partnership. And the reason why I say that, brothers and sisters, and the reason why I know the Holy Spirit gave this to me, is because that term together, again, is mentioned once in verse 5 and twice in verse 6. He says that we were made alive together. He says that we were raised up together. Then he says that we will sit together. That God wants to bless us as a family together, y'all. And it is sweet and it's beautiful when we can appreciate the move of God in our lives together. We can celebrate each other's successes, and we won't get mad and jealous and become envious of my brother getting blessed. Because if God is blessing my brother and we're together, that means God is in the neighborhood. So that means that God is about to move my way, since I'm connected together with my brother. If God is blessing my sister, that means that God is in the neighborhood. So that means that all I got to do is stay connected to my sister and my brother. And since he's blessing my sister and he's blessing my brother, that means I'm up next. Y'all remember, I don't know if y'all played sports like I did growing up, and we would go to the basketball court, and whoever said I got next would be the next person on the court to play in the game. Well, I want to testify tonight. I feel like that right now. I hope you do as well. I got next. Whatever God you're doing in this season, I got next. Whatever way you choose to bless my life, I got next. Whatever you desire to do in the St. John Missionary Baptist Church, 2222 Grace Street, we got next, because we believe that eyes have not seen and ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men the good things that the Lord has in store for those that love him and got next. And I praise the God tonight that I know, I really truly believe, brothers and sisters, that we are up next as it relates to the blessings, because we're operating in a powerful connection in partnership. Oh, glory tonight. Not only do we have the pre-Christ position, verses 1, 2, and 3. Not only do we see the powerful connection of partnership, verses 4, 5, 6, and 7. But lastly, y'all, we see one more thing in verses 8, 9, and 10. I want to show it to you. Listen to verses 8, 9, and 10 one more time. For by grace, you have been saved. That's enough to shout about right there. That the fact that we've been saved by God's amazing grace. But our salvation, listen to the text and look at it. Our salvation doesn't come by our good works. Our salvation doesn't come because we come from a good family. Our salvation doesn't come because we crossed all our T's and dotted all our I's. Our salvation doesn't come by works. Our salvation comes through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Verse 9 says it so clearly, not of works, lest anyone should boast. And then the conclusion says, for we are his workmanship, verse 10, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. I want to lastly show you, brothers and sisters, that verses 8, 9, and 10 shows us a planned course of purpose. It's a planned course of purpose that through God's plan, God provided purpose and significance for the believer. And you got to know that for yourself. You got to know that God has a purpose on your life, that God has a destiny for you, that God has a plan for your life, a plan to prosper you and to give you a future and a hope. You got to know that God has this awesome, awesome strategy already in the works, planned out for your life. And all you got to do is walk in the plan that God has for you. And the problem, unfortunately, with many of us is we're walking and working against the grain. God is telling us to go right and we go left. God is telling us to go north and we go south. We're like Jonah. God told Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach. And Jonah was like, "Nah, I'm not going over there because those folk are crazy. They're wicked. They're evil. And how dare you, God, choose to save them?" Jonah had this self-righteousness complex. He said, "Nah, I'm not going over there." And so he got caught up. Y'all know the story. Swallowed up in the belly of a whale. And God had to, allow the whale to keep him there for 3 days. And that's a prophetic vision of Jesus Christ. 3 days. Amen. In 3 days, he rose from the grave. All of the scripture ties together because the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. And for every Old Testament promise, there's a New Testament principle. And we've got to connect the dots between what God wrote in the Old Testament and what God wrote in the New Testament. And so you've got to know that God has a purpose for your life. You've got to know that God has a plan, and it's a good plan to prosper your life. But here's what I want to show you, y'all. At verse number 8, what the Holy Spirit showed me to tell you tonight is God gifted us with grace and saved us through our faith. That's what I see in verse number 8. Because again, the text says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith and not of yourselves." It is the free gift of God. We didn't work for it. We didn't earn it. We couldn't have done anything to attain it. God just lavishly poured grace on our lives and afforded us the opportunity to receive the free gift of eternal life. And so God gifted us with grace and saved us through our faith. But not only that, I want to show you what verse 9 is tailored to teach. Verse 9 says, "Not of works, lest anyone should boast." In a very succinct and concise way, y'all, I want to tell you that we have no bragging rights. That's what verse 9 is tailored to teach us. We have no bragging rights. We have no reason to brag and boast and get all haughty and all arrogant and all extra and all like we got it going on and we do it right and we're so righteous and we're so perfect and we're so holy. No, no, it's the grace of God. It's the grace of God that saved you, raised you, brought you, sought you, caught you, and redeemed you by the blood of Jesus. It's all about Jesus, y'all. And it's all about God operating in our lives as we trust him in faith. So there's no bragging rights. But then lastly, I want to show you what verse 10 shows, what verse 10 is tailored to teach us. And I'm going to leave you alone tonight, y'all. Here it is. Verse 10, it shows us several things. At verse number 10, I want to show you that the text says, "For we are his workmanship." Now, I've shared in a number of settings, particularly on Sunday mornings, as I preached this text before, that term workmanship is from the Greek term poema, where we get our English term poem. So in essence, we are his workmanship says that we are the poetic expression of God's grace. That when you see me, you see the poem, the poetic expression of God's grace. And when I see you, I see the poetic expression of God's grace all over your life as you walk by faith and not by sight. And so, "For we are his workmanship." This is the office that God has given us. We are his workmanship. We are his trophies. We are the show-off piece to the world of what it looks like to be redeemed by the grace of God. That's our office. But secondly, created in Christ Jesus, that's our origin. That is the concept of our beginning. That before the foundation of the world, we were created in Christ Jesus. That is our origin. But it goes further. What were we created for, y'all? The text says, "For good works." And so now, "for good works" speaks to the operation, y'all. It's the operation because God performed surgery and operated on our hearts that now we can do good works. Hallelujah tonight. Does that not bring back to mind, I preached two Sundays ago, Psalm 51, and the story of David. Of course, y'all know that Nathan the prophet in 2 Samuel chapter 11 approached David because he was living in sin. He had been sleeping with a married woman, Bathsheba, after he saw her bathing. And he said, go get her, I want her. David the king was supposed to be out battling in war, but he chose to hang back. He sees this beautiful woman. He says, I want her. They bring her to him because he's the king. He gets whatever he wants. He sleeps with her, gets her pregnant. She's a married woman. He goes into the war, or he sends for Uriah, her husband, to come back and to try to cover up the sin and cover up the pregnancy and all of that. He tries to get Uriah drunk and all of these things. And Uriah never would go to be intimate with his wife. Long story short, he puts Uriah on the front line and tells the soldiers to retreat back so that the war would heat up and Uriah would be on that front line and would ultimately die right there. And he did. And David thought he was good. David thought all was well. And as soon as Uriah died, he called for Bathsheba and made her one of his wives. And David lived in that sin for a while until Nathan the prophet approached him and told him, David, you living in sin and you all messed up. You need to repent. David acknowledges his sin and he wrote Psalm 32 and he wrote Psalm 51. And at verse 10 in Psalm 51, he asked God, God created me a clean heart and renew in me a steadfast spirit. I've been living in sin for a while now, God. I need you to perform cardiovascular surgery on my heart because my heart has become darkened by sin. My heart has become hard by sin. I've allowed sin to creep into my spirit and now I'm making bad choices. Am I talking to anybody tonight? Now I'm making bad decisions because of sin. Now I'm doing the wrong things, but I'm thinking I'm right because of sin. And that's what sin does, brothers and sisters. It separates us and creates a barrier between us and God. But God is so faithful that he will forgive us of our sins if we would only confess. And so what I want to tell you is, for good works is the operation. It's God performing surgery on our hearts. But then the text goes on to say, which God prepared beforehand. This is the orchestration, y'all. This is the orchestration. It's the orchestration because God orchestrated his plan and purpose in our lives that we finally should walk in them. And should walk in them is our obligation. Since God has been so faithful, as a consequence of God's leading and loving, the believer has a religious duty and a holy obligation to walk in the will of God. Since God has saved us, since God has raised us, since God has forgiven us, since God has been so kind and gracious to us, all we got to do now is walk in the precepts and the statutes and the commandments of our God. This past Sunday, we preached from Psalm number 19. It's another Psalm of David. And David, who has a high value of the Word of God, used several synonyms as it relates to the Word of God. He used the term statutes. He used the term commandments. He used the term ordinances and statutes and testimonies. He used all these terms to signify the power of the Word of God. And tonight, brothers and sisters, I want to let you know, in case you forgot, that the Word of God has power. But you won't be able to access the power until you do what the Word of God says do. Because you can't just be a hearer of the Word. You got to move to be a doer of the Word. That's how the power of God is activated in our lives, by not just memorizing the Word and reading the Word and studying the Word. We got to put the Word to work. The Word will work when you work the Word. I need to say that again. The Word will work when you work the Word. Well, brothers and sisters, that's all I have for us tonight. We see the pre-Christ position in verses 1, 2, and 3. We see the powerful connection of partnership in verses 4 through 7. And we were able to see, lastly, according to verses 8 through 10, that God has a plan, course, a purpose for our lives when we walk in the newness of life, all by the amazing grace of God. Hallelujah for his word tonight. Hallelujah. Thank God for all that he's doing. Before we close out and pray, and we're going to pray for several names on our prayer list, I always like to offer the opportunity to each of you, St. John family and friends and supporters of the ministry, to give a love gift if you feel led to present your offering, if you did not have an opportunity possibly to give on this past Sunday. You can give right now, and you can do so by texting to give. The phone number is 210-529-8631. I'll say it again. The phone number to text to give is 210-529-8631. Or you can go to our church website, which is www.stjohnmbcongray.org. And on that homepage, you'll see on the left-hand side, give. You can click on that term, give, and you can give your love gift even right now, tonight. You can also go to our Tithely app if you have that application on your device, and you can look up the St. John Church on Gray, and you can give to us through Tithely as well. And we thank God for your gifts. God bless you, and may he keep you forevermore. We're going to close out in just a moment, but I want us to be in prayer for Brother Horace Roberts. We've been praying for him. We want to continue to lift him to the Lord. And of course, we're praying for Sister Ozella Roberts as well. We're praying for Sister Mildred Woodson Williams also. We're praying for Sister Shirley Harrell. We're praying for Deacon Michael Hearn Sr. We're praying for Deacon J.T. Hearn Jr. We're praying for Sister Vina Coleman. We're also praying in a special way for Deacon Ronald Wilkins. I got a message on yesterday from Sister Sharon Wilkins that he is in the hospital, and he took sick on Sunday evening, as a matter of fact. And so we want to pray his healing. We want to pray for God to touch him and bless him in a great way. So we're praying for all these things, and we're asking God to move in a mighty way. Let's go ahead and close out in prayer at this time. Thank you all so much again for your faithfulness. Let's pray. God, we thank you, we love you, and we appreciate you so very much for all that you're doing in our lives. We know you to be the faithful God. We know you to be Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals our bodies. So God, I want to lift up every single situation that seems impossible, God, as it relates to healing. We know, God, that you are the healer. We know, God, that there's nothing too hard for you. You can do anything, God. So all of these things that concern us, all of these situations that weigh on our hearts, we present them to you as an act of worship right now. And we pray, God, that you would move mightily. We pray, God, that you would move miraculously. And we pray, God, that you would get the glory out of everything that happens in our lives. Before we close out, God, we want to just ask you for the forgiveness of sins, because we always come up short and we constantly miss the mark. But great is thy faithfulness. And we honor you so much right now, Jesus Christ. Have your way, God, in our lives. And we'll be careful to praise you forever and ever and ever. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray this prayer in faith. We say hallelujah and we say amen. Praise God tonight. I love you, St. John Missionary Baptist Church, family, friends. I'm praying for each of you. God bless you. Have a great evening. And we will see you on Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. We have Sunday school, of course, at 9 a.m. We look forward to seeing you both in person and virtually. God bless you. Have a great evening. Take care. No prayer call tomorrow. No prayer call tomorrow. I will be in class. Thank you for your prayers in advance for that as well. Amen. God bless you. Love you. Bye.